मैडम आप पढ़ाएंगे क्या? ओके सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट पल्स कोड मॉड्यूलेशन टेक्निक व्हिच इज द पार्ट ऑफ आवर मॉड्यूल 5 एंड इन व्हिच ऑलरेडी वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द क्वांटाइजेशन प्रोसेस हाउ मेनी टाइप ऑफ क्वांटाइजेशन आर देयर टिल नाउ वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट यूनिफॉर्म क्वांटाइजेशन ओके and uniform quantization means your step size between the different levels. The levels are identified with respect to quantization and that quantizer levels is also framed with respect to the decision boundary. Now the relationship between the levels and the decision boundary is the decision boundary will be one more than of our levels. What we have seen in the previous class. If the number of levels are 4, that means the decision level will be 5. And those levels will be the midpoints of the between two decision boundaries. Suppose D1, D2, D3, D4 and D5 are there, that means there are 4 levels will be identified as L1, L2, L3 and L4. And we have seen that if the distance between two decision boundary and the distance between two decision levels is remain constant, that constant factor is called as a step size. Okay, if the step size remains constant throughout the process, then we can say it is called as a uniform quantization. Okay, and also we have seen how many type of uniform quantization is there. First, we have seen it is a mid-read quantizer, and as well as we have seen it is a mid-rise quantizer. Okay, mid-rise quantizer basically it is a horizontal or vertical, we have seen, and according to that we have also checked that step size remain constant for both the cases. If the step size remain constant between the levels, that means it is called as a uniform quantization process. If the step size change with respect to a modulating signal, then we will say it is called non-uniform quantization process. Okay, now application of this quantization we will see in this pulse code modulation. Okay, now pulse code modulation itself indicates that it converts your analog signal into a digital signal. The pulses are encoded with a certain of binary bits, what I have discussed in the previous class. First, the modulating signal, which is a continuous signal, is converted into number of samples. After the number of samples, it will be quantized to the nearest value. Then the quantized value will be allocated with the number of binary bits, depend upon the number of levels decided by the quantizer. If the quantizer decides there are 8 levels are there, that means each level will be assigned with 3 binary bits. Okay, 000, 001, 010, 011, 100, 101, then 110 and 111. So these are the basic combination will be assigned to the different levels. Depend upon the number of levels, your binary bit is going to be assigned to those particular levels. And once this binary data is assigned, the data is available in the form of parallel. Okay, so it is in a form of parallel. So we need to convert that parallel to series before transmission, and it is done within the encoder. The encoder will extract the binary data or assign the binary data to the pulses, to the quantized value. All are available in the parallel form. It will convert into a series manner. So when I am transmitting with the help of this encoder output IDC, it is a series of binary bits. Okay, it is a series of binary bits. But within this encoder, the parallel data or the parallel levels are there, in that assigned binary bits are available in parallel form. You need to convert that parallel value into the serial combination. Okay, so here you can see there is a transmitter. In this transmitter, what happens? Message signal, which is a continuous in nature, m of t or x of t, you can consider any of these two parameters, you can consider g of t, you can consider f of t, whatever it is. Okay, it enters the low pass filter. First of all, you need to limit the particular signal. You have to limit the band size, that bandwidth of the modulating signal, so that the band limited signal will be identified. So the purpose of this LPR is to limit the band, is to limit a particular frequency band. So a band limited signal will be the output of LPR. So here I will write it is a band limited signal. Okay, band limited signal. Now this band limited signal is sampled. So here I will write x of NTS, the sample, number of samples will be generated. Now in the previous class we have seen quantization, in which we have provided the sampled output and we are getting the quantized signal. So here I will get xt of NTS. So it is a quantized signal. Now this quantized signal, when it is enters to the encoder, number of levels will be identified. Each level will be assigned with the number of binary bits. We have a relation L is equal to 2 to the power n. So if there are 4 number of levels are there, each level is represented by 2 to binary bits, that is n. Okay. So this encoder will receive all those parallel data. Okay. All those parallel data, and it will provide the series combination of binary bit or the series data. The purpose of encoder is to encode the binary. It will assign the binary data to the quantized signal and convert from parallel to the series manner. Okay, that is the purpose of a PCM transmitter. Done. Okay. Now once it is generated, what will happen? It will travel towards receiver. It will cover certain distance. Okay, if a far distance, basically digital systems are used for a far distance communication. So pulse code generated, it is PCM signals are generated. Okay, now when we transmit signal for a long distance between transmitter and receiver, we used to keep some sort of repeaters. We used to keep some sort of reconstruction devices who will reconstruct the received pulses into the original manner, and then it can be again retransmitted towards the receiver. Okay. So you can see when it is in channel or when it is from a transmitter end to the receiver end, I have placed some repeaters. Repeaters at a certain equidistance. If you consider for optical cases or optical transmitter, 40 kilometer distance one repeater is present. But if it is for line communication and if it is for coaxial cable, whatever it is, 4 km or maximum to maximum 10 km distance we have, the repeaters are available at equidistance. It will reconstruct your original signal. Okay. So repeaters are available between transmitter and receiver. So repeaters are nothing but the reconstruction or the regenerator of the pulse, regenerator of the PCM signal. Because when I am transmitting the PCM signal in a particular channel, some additive noise will be added to my information, which corrupt the signal, which deteriorate the signal strength. So how to regenerate it? Regeneration is done with the help of these repeaters. So here you can see, as I have written, PCM signal plus noise component is fed to these repeaters. In this repeater, it will reconstruct to the original signal. As you can see, there are 5 distance I have taken. Okay, means this is the output, not distance wise. So at distance 1, I am transmitting a pulse, means I am at transmitter. Okay. When it is delivered in a particular channel, you can see the pulse strength reduces. This is also reduces with respect to distance 2, with respect to distance 3, with respect to distance 4. Now, from distance 1 to distance 5, I have kept a repeater at distance 5. Now, these all distorted pulses received at a distance 5. So, at distance 5, I have kept a repeater who will reconstruct to the original signal. So at distance 5, you can see the pulse of this transmitted pulse is same. It is reconstructed. There is a steps through which the distorted signal can be reconstructed into the original transmitted signal. So it is having a certain step. That is the block, or that is the part of a repeater, the principle of a repeater. Within that repeater, the three small blocks are available. First, since the amplitude reduced, means amplitude need to be increased, there must be an amplifier, okay? Next, as you can see, the time period reduces or increases due to the effect of noise. So that means there must be a time circuit, okay? Next, how to justify the amplitude is reached or not? So there must be a decision maker will be there. If the decision maker is there, he will decide whether the binary bit 0 is received or binary bit 1 is received. If binary bit 1 is received, then the received pulse must be greater than the threshold potential and he will generate binary bit 1. We will discuss all those things bit by bit. Now, as you can see that at the first distance of a transmitter part, the signal quality is very, very good. But as we have delivered and we are measuring at a distance 2, 3 and 4, the signal quality deteriorates with respect to amplitude and with respect to time. Now these are the two factors come into picture if I am transmitting, if I am using the pulse. Because pulse is having two characteristics. One, amplitude. Second, time. Okay, so with respect to these two, I need to decide about my circuit because my repeaters must consist of three components. First, it must amplify the signal. Second, it must synchronize the pulse. And third, most important thing, the decision maker, whether the received signal is a binary bit 1 or received signal is a binary bit 0. Okay, how? Let's see. Now, here, you can see there is a repeater I have made. 1 minute. So, as you can see, there is a repeater. It is having certain steps. So, when I am receiving the PCM signal, with it, noise is also. So it is, I have written, received PCM plus noise, okay? Now these two things enters to the amplifier equalizer. Amplifier equalizer means it will amplify the signals. It will amplify both, received signal with noise also. But I need to synchronize the time period. Then only I will generate the transmitted signal. So amplification is done. This amplification output is fed to the timing circuit and to the decision device. Timing circuit is need to synchronize the pulse time period, this one, this time period, okay, pulse time period. And the decision device is having a certain threshold. Let us consider this is the threshold lambda, okay. Here, the two output I am considering D1 and D2. Let us consider. D1 and D2 is the output of this amplifier for 1 and 1 bit. I don't know what is that bit. Now, in this lambda, the decision will be decided like this. If D1 is greater than lambda, okay? If the D1, the received signal strength after amplification, if it is greater than the threshold potential available in this decision maker, then the whole system will decide to generate binary bit 1. Okay? After synchronizing, this timing circuit is used to synchronize the pulse, the purpose of that. Okay? Now, if the decision amplification output, if the amplification output is greater than the threshold potential, then it will be decided to generate binary bit 1. Similarly, if the received signal strength is very, very low and it is amplified and still it is not greater than your threshold potential. So D2 is, if it is less than lambda, then the decision will be 0 for a particular time period because it will synchronize that particular time period. Okay? So you need to, the repeater will decide whether my intensity what I have received is greater than the threshold potential or not. If it is greater than threshold potential, the binary bit 1 will be generated and it will be transmitted. Okay? But if the signal strength deteriorates after amplification also it is not reaching to the threshold potential, then the decision will be on binary bit 0 for that particular time period. This is the principle of repeater. Okay, once this repeater is done, then comes to this receiver. In this receiver, it is just as a reverse method of this particular transmitter. In repeater, in receiver also, we have a regenerator, we have a repeater, because we are receiving PCM with noise. We need to reconstruct it, and then from that pulse code modulated signal, the original message signal need to be recovered. How? Let's see. So first, the received signal is the PCM with noise enters to the repeater, reconstruction takes place, PCM signal is available here, okay, with small sort of noise. Then it enters to the decoder, because here it is encoder is there, it will decode it. Binary data will be converted into the analog signal with the help of certain methods. So this, after the decoder, it will enter to the reconstruction filter, because we have sampling and holding technique to reconstruct the original message signal, what we have discussed in the previous classes also. So this reconstruction filter will reconstruct to the original modulating signal. And last is the destination. So when we are using encoder means we are using in the transmitter. Decoder means we are using at a receiver end. We are decoding the received pulses. We are decoding the received pulses with respect to the modulating signal. So this is the part of, or you can say, the working principle of PCM for transmitter, receiver and repeaters. But how this particular thing happens? What are the relations behind it? How these particular levels are identified? How these numbers are identified? How the number of binary bits are identified? What are the quantization levels are there? Those need to be calculated. Those things will come into picture. And here we are not calculating SNR. We are calculating signal to quantization noise ratio. This is this one important thing you must remember. Generally, we are depending upon SNR. But when we come into picture with respect to PCM, this SNR we are not calculating, rather than we are calculating signal to quantization noise ratio. And that signal to quantization noise ratio will be calculated with respect to this PCM transmission. Because in this, the quantization will come into picture. Because that is the heart of this PCM technique. How we are converting analog signal into a digital signal, and that will be a streamline. Here in encoder, the parallel data will be converted into the series data, and the bit stream will be transmitted. Okay. Okay. So this is called signal degradation. There are two basic reasons behind this signal degradation. Is first, the unwanted electrical noise, means internal noise generated within a particular system. And second, when it is delivered to a particular channel, that is called transfer function of a particular transmission media. The transmission media is a free space, or a particular channel will be available, whose own transfer function means own characteristics is there. Due to that characteristics, your signal degradation will be taken place. So these are the two reasons behind which the signal deteriorates or signal degradation takes place while transmission of a PCM signal. Now we are going to calculate what is the signal to quantization noise ratio if I am transmitting the sinusoid signal as my message signal. Similarly, if I am transmitting the non-sinusoid signal, what will be my signal to quantization noise ratio? These are the two things which many times come in the university questions. What is the signal to quantization noise ratio for sinusoid signal transmission, as well as what is the signal to quantization noise ratio if it is non-sinusoid signal transmission? Non-sinusoid signal transmission means telephone lines. Remember this. This is a hint I am giving. Non-sinusoid transmission lines, transmission signals are telephone line signals. So when these telephone line signals will come, you need to write, or you need to go through the analysis with respect to non-sinusoidal signals. Okay, so first we will discuss about the sinusoidal signal, and then we will calculate the signal to noise ratio. Okay, so the signal to quantization noise ratio. So let us consider a sinusoidal signal. So sinusoidal signal is like this, which is also which I can write as a cosine signal. So this is your x of t, this is am, and this is minus am, and this is the time period t. Okay. Now, as what we have discussed in the previous class, that the certain factors are there. Step factor is there. Now, how we are calculating step size del? Del is equals to vx minus vl divided by l. Number of levels. So I need to identify. So what is the maximum value? Am, like this I can write, divided by L. L is equals to how much? L is equals to 2 to the power n. Done. So this is my step size. If the step size remains constant, then I can say it is called uniform quantization. Here I am discussing with respect to uniform quantization, where del is remain constant. Okay? Next, what is the signal power? Okay, so signal power I can write, it is am square divided by t, because if I will write x of t or y of t, anything, here I will write am cos omega mt. Okay. Here it is omega. So what is the amplitude am? So what is the power content am square by? So that is the signal power. Next we will calculate signal to quantization noise ratio SQNR, and the quantization noise power we have calculated in the earlier class, that is del square by 2l. Okay. Now what is del square? Del is 2am by 2 to the power n. You have to substitute here, divided by 12. And then signal to quantization noise ratio means the signal power divided by quantization noise power. Quantization noise power. So signal power is am square divided by 2 whole divided by 2am divided by l. 2am by this is whole square, and into 1 by 12, because this is del square divided by 12. Now once it is done, you need to calculate this. So am square will be cancelled out. Okay. So SQNR is equals to this am square will cancelled out, and we have 3 divided by 2 L square. This L will go up after dissemination of this 4 into 2, this is 2 into 4 is 8 divided by 12, you will get around 3 by 2 L square. Now 3 by 2 L square means it is 2 to the power n whole to the power 2. So 3 by 2, 2 to the power 2 n. Then, so this is your SQNR. But whenever the signal to noise ratio or signal to quantization noise ratio we are calculating, we need to calculate in terms of dB. So if it is in terms of dB, I have to take time log both the sides. So SQNR in dB, I will take 10 log base 10 of 3 by 2. Okay. Now this is multiplication. So it is 10 log base 10 2 to the power 12. Done. So 10 log of 3 by 2, take this to an outside, you will get 20 n log of 2. Okay. Now if you solve this 10 log of 3 by 2, you will get around 1.76 plus this, you will get around 6n. 20 into log 2, if you multiply it, near about 6 you will get. So it is sqnr in dB for sinusoidal signal is 1.76 plus 6n. In some of the book it will be written in terms of 1.76, in some of the book it will be written in 1.8 plus 6n. In not to confuse, both are same, but small difference will be there, 0.2 difference will come. In some of the book it will be around 1.6 plus 6n, n is the number of binary bits, and or you can represent 1.8n plus 6n. So this is the basic difference. For the time being, this is for sinusoid signal. Sinusoid signal. Okay. One hint I will give, because we need we will solve few questions on this, then we will derive for the non-sinusoidal in the next class. For this is the first case. Second case is for non-sinusoidal signal. Sinusoidal signal. For non-sinusoidal signal means it is telephone lines. Telephone signals. These are non-sinusoidal signal. If it is non-sinusoidal signal, my signal to quantization noise ratio is 4.76 plus 6n, or I can write 4.8 plus 6n, just a difference of 3. In sinusoidal it is 1.8 plus 6n, but it is non-sinusoidal it is 4.8 plus 6n. The derivation I will do later on. For the time being, we will go through only the relations, because now we will solve numericals regarding this. So I am discussing this relation. Okay. So if it is sinusoidal, this is my sqnr. If it is my non-sinusoidal, this will be my signal to quantization noise ratio. Okay. And this relation is also called as 6 dB rule. Remember this, because most of the time in university questions they are asking about 6 dB rule. Use this 6 dB rule. So if it is written 6 dB rule, means the signal to quantization ratio you have to write as, if it is sinusoidal, 1.8 plus 6n, or if it is non-sinusoidal you have to write as 4.8 plus 6n. Only 3 difference will be there. Okay. So this is your relation. This is called 3 dB rule. Now we will calculate the transmission bandwidth for the PCM signal. Okay. Because that is also one most important factor. Because as we are transmitting binary bits, it depends upon its bandwidth, and depends upon sampling frequency, depends upon your quantization levels, depends upon number of binary bits and all. Okay. So bandwidth of PCM. Bandwidth of PCM. How to calculate the bandwidth of PCM? First, we need to identify the quantizer level. So quantizer level. First you have to identify the quantizer level. So that is n, which is equals to 2 to the power n, where n is called number of bits. Each level will be assigned with the number of binary bits. If L is equals to 16, each level will be represented by 4 bits, because L is equals to 2 to the power 4. Okay. Next, number of bits per second, or you can say signaling rate for PCM. Signaling rate for PCM. So here, signaling rate, or you can say bit rate, n into fs. Okay? What is fs? Fs is the sampling frequency. So here you can write twice of n into fm. Fm is the maximum frequency available in your modulating signal. And your transmission bandwidth, that is bt, is equals to rb by 2, half of the signaling rate. So twice n into fm divided by 2 n into fm. Okay, so your bandwidth will become n times of fm. So this is bt. So these are the fundamental relations through which any sort of questions given in terms of PCM, it will be easy to calculate, because these are the fundamental relations. First, you need to identify the number of levels if it is given, or number of binary bits. Then you have to calculate the signaling rate, or it is called as a bit rate. Then you have to calculate the transmission bandwidth, which is half of the bit rate. These are the simple relations. With the help of the simple relations, the numerical can be solved. Okay. So basically, when this question comes in PCM, four things they ask. First, what is number of levels? Second, what is bit rate? Third, what is the transmission bandwidth? Fourth, most important thing, what is signal to quantization noise ratio with respect to sinusoidal signal or with respect to non-sinusoidal signal? Okay, these are the fundamental questions. Very easy. These are very easy terms. Okay, you will solve few questions. So this is one question. As you can see, a signal of bandwidth, a signal of bandwidth, let me write the not bandwidth, I will write what is bit rate, or you can write what is sampling frequency, So bandwidth is 2.5 kHz, sampled and coded by PCM system, okay? The coded signal is transmitted over the channel of a bit rate of 50 kbps. And find SQNR, N, L and FS. Like this is the signal. Now, as it is given, the signal is given, it is nothing discussed about telephone lines, nothing else. So you have to consider this one as a sinusoid signal. Okay? Now in sinusoid signal, the total bandwidth is given to you. Bt is 3.5 kHz. Okay? Now what is the relationship between Bt and the bit rate? And your bit rate is given as 50 kbps. Rg is equals to 50 kbps. This is your signaling rate. Done? Now depend upon this signaling rate, n into fs you can write. Okay, a signal bandwidth, it is a band limited signal whose bandwidth is this. So it is fm is equals to 3.5 kilohertz. Not transmission bandwidth. Transmission bandwidth is different. So signal bandwidth is FM is 3.5 kilohertz is given. RB is equals to 50 kbps is given. So RB we have seen that RB is equals to N into FS, or you can write it is twice N into FM. So from this you can calculate N. It is 50 into 10 to the power 3 divided by 2 into FM. FM is how much? 3.5 into 10 to the power 3. So this cancel out. So it is 50 divided by 7. So 50 divided by 7 means 6 point, near about 7.142 you will get. 7.142. So N cannot be a decimal, N must be a binary bit. So if it is 7.142, the number of binary bits will be 8 we have to consider. Though it is greater than 7, 7.142 means one more bit you have to consider. So number of binary bit is 8. So number of binary bit is 8. Now how many number of levels are there? So it is 2 to the power 8. So that is 2 to the power 4 into 2 to the power 4. How much it is? 16 into 16. Then, so 16 into 16 means how much? This is 6. And this is 9. This is 6. So it is 5. This is 256. Okay. So this is 256. Number of levels are available. Next, we have to calculate FS. Now what is FS? FS is equal to twice FM. So 2 into 3.5, that is 7 kilohertz. Done. It is also done. Number of binary bit is known. Number of level is known. Sampling frequency is known. And only the thing is left, SQNR. Now since it is a sinusoidal signal, SQNR I can write 1.8 plus 6n. So this is 1.8 plus 6 into n is our 8. Here you can see n is 8. So 6 into 8 it is 48. 48 plus 1 it is 49.8. So this much dB. So this is SQNR in dB. So like this question will come in your exam. So this is the simple example of a PCMO. Now one more example we will solve. So as you can see, this is one more question with respect to the PCL. Okay? So here, a 10 kHz sinusoid signal, already it has given, sinusoid. Sinusoid means our SQNR, we have to consider 1.8 plus 6N, okay? So 10 kHz SQ means sinusoid signal means the bandwidth of that sinusoid signal is FM and it is 10 kHz. Whose amplitude is AM, is 1 volt, okay? Is quantized to have the SQNR, it is given. Signal to quantization noise ratio in dB, it is equals to 45 dB. That is also given. Only we have to calculate the number of bits, bit rate and the transmission bandwidth. If condition is given, sampling frequency is twice of Nyquist rate. Okay? So first of all, I have to calculate what is Nyquist rate. So F, let us Q, Nyquist rate is twice of FM. So twice of FM means twice of 10. 10 kHz, so it is 20 kHz. So this is the Nyquist rate. Now my sampling frequency is twice the Nyquist rate, FM. So that means it is 40 kHz. Then over next, we need to calculate N. As we know, it is a sinusoid. SQNR in dB, it will be 1.8 plus 6N is equals to 45 dt. From this relation, can we determine n? Yes, we can determine. So n is equals to 45 minus 1.8 divided by 6. So here we will get 2, this is 4, this is 3, so 43.2 and 6. So near about 8 point something we will get n, or 7, that is 7, let us consider it is 7.2. So n is 7.2 means n equivalent value will be 8, because it is 7.2, it is greater than 7, n is a number of binary bits, 7.2 cannot be a binary bit, so 8 number of binary bits are there. Next, we have to calculate what is the bit rate. So RB is equal to how much? N into FS. N is how much? It is 8. FS is how much? It is 40. So it is 320 kilohertz. Over. What is the band transmission bandwidth? The transmission bandwidth is bit rate divided by 2. So bit rate divided by 2 means it is 160 kilohertz. Over. Simple calculation. Like this question will come in your exam. So this sort of question need to be practiced. Okay. So next class we will discuss more number of numericals and the thing what it is left with respect to PCM, non-uniform quantization is left, that we will discuss, and then we will go for delta modulation, in which how the delta will change, how the delta will remain constant. If the variation with respect to delta, with respect to modulating signal, then we will say it is called delta modulation. But there is also two types. If the delta remain constant while modulation, we will say it is called uniform delta modulation. But if the delta changes with respect to modulating signal, then it is called adaptive delta modulation, which is not in your syllabus. Only delta modulation is in your syllabus. So two, three points are left that we will cover in the next class. For the time being, thank you. Okay, one more question I will discuss, then we will wind up because time is still there. I thought that one more question we will take up and we need to complete it. So as you can see, the signal G of T is given. Two different frequencies are there with two different amplitudes. Okay, multi-tone signal. It is quantized by rounding off using 12-bit quantizer. 12-bit quantizer means the N is given as 12. Okay, and here we have to calculate what is the SQLR, RMS SQLR. Okay, so how to calculate this signal to quantization noise ratio? So as we know that signal to quantization noise ratio is a ratio of a signal power divided by the quantization noise power. Okay, now let's see how to calculate. So number of levels will be 2 to the power 12, because this is the relation. Okay, next we have to calculate del. So del is how much? So 2 g max divided by del. What is the maximum amplitude available in this particular signal, combined maximum? So amplitude is how much? 2 and 4. Because first amplitude AM1 is 2 volt, second amplitude AM2 is 4 volt. Okay? Now the maximum will be how much? 6. So twice of 6 divided by 2 to the power 12. So 12 divided by 2 to the power 12. So your del will come around 0.0029. So this is just step 6 del. Next, the quantization noise error. So quantization noise power is how much? It is del square by 12. So it is 0.0029 whole square divided by 12. If you solve this, around 0.7 into 10 to the power minus 6 you will get. Okay, noise power is over. Now signal power we have to calculate. So signal power, if I will calculate for this multi-tone, I will get AM square divided by 2 first one, AM2 square divided by 2 for the second one. So first one is 4 divided by 2 because 2 square is 4 and 4 square is 16 divided by 2. So this is 2 plus 8, that is 10 watt. And SQNR is equals to 10 divided by 0.7 into 10 to the power 6, which is near about 14.28 into 10 to the power 6. So this is the value, SQNR, RMS value. Here it was not asked about dB. If it is dB, then one simple step, SQNR into dB, which is equals to 10 log of this 14.28 into 10 to the power 6. That is the simple way to calculate in dB. If it is not asked in terms of dB, it is asked in terms of RMS, you have to solve up to this much. And that to signal to quantization noise ratio do not have any sort of unit, because it is a dimensional quantity, it is a constant value. Okay? So for today, we wind up here. Next class, we will discuss more numericals with respect to PCR. Thank you all for your patience.